Services and Training, FMC Omar here. The Head of Administration, FMC Omar here. The Director of Postgraduate Studies, FMC Omar here. The Chairman, MD Khan, FMC Omar here. The Distinguished Inaugural Lecturer. The Heads of Various Departments, FMC Omar here. The Chairman and the Heads of Professional Associations, Traditional Rulers, and Distinguished Ladies and Gentlemen, you're hard welcome to this wonderful occasion. I want to crave your indulgence to stay put, sit tight, in all distant time. We're going to be done with this wonderful occasion. Like you rightly said, my name is Henry Onyewi Fair. You can also call me MC PP Raw from Family Love 99.9 FM Omaha, the Niger Station. Chief Host, Professor Azubi K. Onyebuchi, the MD of FMC Omaha. The special guest of honor, Professor Ken Ozilu, the National President of MDCAM, ably represented by Dr. Moses Chebo, the National Secretary. The Head, Clinical Services and Training, FMC Omohe, Dr. Ogochukwu Onyewoko is here with us. Onyonoro, actually, pardon me. The Head for Administration, FMC Omohe, Dr. Roland Ebemo is here with us. Ebemo is here with us. The Director, Postgraduate Studies, FMC Omohe, Dr. Ikechukwu Ogbonna. Is there one of these round of applause for him also? The Chairman, MDCAM, FMC Omohe Chapter, the Order President, Dr. Ogbonna Goswell. And also, ladies and gentlemen, with a clapping ovation, I would like us to recognize the distinguished inaugural lecturer today, no other president, Dr. Eri Naya Ntoka. I should also have the heads of various departments seated right here, and also chairman and heads of various professional bodies, members of the press, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I still have some names to recognize, then we forge ahead. They're already seated here, but you can stay put while I recognize you wherever you are. You're already seated at the high table. I also have the chief host on the high table, Professor Azubike, which is here with us. You're welcome, sir. Professor Iweaba, the provost of Gregory University. Please, wherever you are, I'd like you to recognize, just give me some wave. Professor Webade, you're highly welcome, sir. Also have your Professor Amakalo, the Deputy Provost, Gregory University. Professor Anakalo, the Deputy Provost, Gregory University, Uturu. Please, wherever you are, you're highly recognized. We have the father of the inaugural lecturer, the father of the inaugural lecturer. Daddy, please, I don't know where you are, but if I believe not, you're highly welcome, sir. Please, a round of applause for the father of the inaugural lecturer. You're highly welcome, sir.
Let's be all standing. We clap for all the dignitaries. We are going to pray and recognize the presence of the Almighty who made us all we are today. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this privilege. We thank you for this honor. We thank you, O God, for every provision you've made in good health and everything you've made possible for us, even the good weather, to make today a success. Father, we ask, O God, for your presence. We ask for your presence to be with us. The aim of this meeting, Father, to unify the body, to make for fellowship, to make for advancement in management of patients, and in every aspect, of God, we pray for prosperity upon the MDCAM, upon the hospital, upon the management, of God. We ask for your grace to continue. Father, please bless this gathering, bless everyone that have come, that made our time to come. When we look at the end of it, we shall look back and be grateful that we came. We also ask for grace for continuity, O God, that it will not end this year. We are planning, O God, that this will be a continuum. Please help us, Lord, as we deliberate today, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's put our hands together for the King of Kings.
Thank you very much, Lord, for that. the physician's pledge. Please one standing. The physician's pledge. To the led by Dr. Chukwu Emeka. Dr. Chukwu Emeka is all we know. Highly welcome, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, this pledge is not for everybody. It's strictly for those who have been mentor. But everybody will keep on standing. So we start. I just need you just follow me. The physician's pledge. As a member of the medical profession, I solemnly pledge to dedicate my life to the service of humanity, the health and well-being of my patients will be my first consideration. I will respect the autonomy and dignity of my patient. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life. I will not permit considerations of age, disease, or disability. Creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality. Political affiliation, race, sexual orientation, social standing, or any other factor to intervene between my duty and my patient. I will respect the secrets that are confined in me even after the patient has died. I practice my profession with conscience and dignity and in accordance with good medical practice. I foster the honor and noble traditions of the medical profession. I give to my teachers, colleagues, and students the respect and gratitude that is their due. I share my medical knowledge for the benefit of the patient and the advancement of healthcare. I will attend to my own health, well-being, and abilities in order to provide care of the highest standard. I will not use my medical knowledge to violate human rights and civil liberties, even under threat. I make these promises solemnly, freely, and upon my honor. Thank you. Everybody sit.
Thank you. I just received an information. Please. So, if you hear your name, I would like you to come to the high table. Dr. Okoye Chukwu Emeka, the chairman, MDCA, FMC, Asaba. I have been conducted to say, Dr. Okoye Chukwu Emeka, the chairman, MDCA, FMC, Asaba. The high welcome, sir. Please, sir. The high is in the high table.
We want to welcome a special guest, two special person. I come from River State, representing River State Government Hospitals, Dr. Robinson. Please come to the meeting.
Dr. Robinson, you're highly welcome, sir.
The chairman of this occasion, Professor Augustine Owagwe, the Vice Chancellor, Gregory University, our chief host, the one and only able and dynamic Medical Director of FNCMI, Professor Azubike Onyebuchi. The special guest of honor for this event, Professor Kenneth Ozoilo, the National President of MDCAN, who is ably represented here today by Dr. Moses Chingle. I hope I pronounced it right. Dr. Chingle is the National Secretary of MDCAN. Secretary General of MDCAN, thank you. The Head Clinical Services and Training, Dr. of FM Sumaya, Dr. Botuku Onyangara, and then our Head of Administration, FM Sumaya, Mr. Ronald Ebemo, the Provost of Brethren University, Professor Weha, Deputy Provost, Professor Awa Ndalo, our own Chairman MDCAN FM Sumaya Chapter, Dr. Oswin Ogunaya, the distinguished inaugural lecturer for today, the reason why we are here today, Dr. Eninaya Nduka, heads of various departments here present, chairman and heads of various professional bodies here present, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen. It is with great privilege that I am in your midst today. I thank the MDCAN chairman, the other executives and members for this opportunity to chair this LOC of the maiden edition of Distinguished Medical Specialist Annual Lecture. I also will use this opportunity to thank the members of the LOC for their sacrifices to ensure that this event became a reality. Being a maiden event, the LOC has put up an event that will be epic in nature. Based on this, we have put up programs that will enlighten and educate us. The programs are actually timed, and this includes my address. Therefore, I will not waste any further time, as I, on behalf of the LOC members, wish you the best of moments. Enjoy the rest of the program. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much. That was a wonderful address by Dr. Ikechukwu Ogbonna. Thank you very much. The chairman of the MDCAN will present the call award. The chairman of the occasion will perform the traditional rites.
I want to go straight away to make the presentation to the call award. And I want to hurriedly hand it over to my boss, the medical director of Federal Medical Center, Professor Onyebuchi Azubuike, to perform the rites as required by our tradition. Thank you very much.
MDCAN Chairman, now wow. Abia, Mamman. FM Sumaya Kelen. Nigeria Nile Wesolo. MDCAN Chairman, Iman Ojana, and we are here soon. Uba, we got a school. Chairman, I of this occasion, Professor Augustine Mbu. Ndi Bola Yoko. Association
I'm a head of administration.
Nigeria man man. No, them there can tell off it. I got a tank as well as you have to make it there. I did get a chicken when you make a crack in the man. Do to what? When you look like us like him, we came by the man and Nigeria man. I grant to come to you with the Ramia. I could have made the Aganama Jesus. All the age of an enemy. Chineke biko ya mlantara ibu watatando. Ibu suka mputa. Wana kuka mati mmatuna ha Jesus. Ime nini wani. Kana kubuli haka za kwezi. Maha Jesus Christ kubuli wani.
At this point I would like you to make welcome to the microphone. The MDCAN chairman. For his address. The other person that Dr. Obunena Goswin. Please, with a round of applause, as he makes his way to you, the podium.
Very much. Let me stand on the existing protocols because of time. I really want to first appreciate all our... Sorry to be interrupting. Today is a dream come true for Medical and Dental Consultant Association of Nigeria, Federal Medical Center of Umuahia. Federal Medical Center of Umuahia. This journey started about 2 years ago when the current executive officers of the association, as you told us, the distinguished medical specialist annual inaugural lecture was conceived to celebrate the professional achievements of medically qualified consultants. In the same way, universities celebrate professors. Medical specialists are unique because they not only provide the highest level of specialized medical care, they train and mentor other medical specialists in training, commonly referred to as resident doctors, fresh graduates from the medical school and undergraduate medical students. The journey to become a medical specialist is not a bread and butter endeavor. It takes a lot of rigorous and intense professional and academic discipline to qualify as fellow of the postgraduate medical colleges and get certified as medically qualified specialist. The journey doesn't end there. We continue to save lives with our knowledge and skills as well as contribute to the development of the art of medical practice. Today, we are here to showcase the contributions to the knowledge and practice of medicine by one of us. May I add that since we assume office as executive officers of MDCAN FM Sumwaya, we have been doing our best to encourage continued professional development of our members. For instance, we have revived our Pioneer Medical Journal after 6 years of moribundity. The Pioneer Medical Journal is a recognized peer-reviewed journal. It provides a platform for our members and other medical researchers to publish their research. We started the MDCAN Scholarship Program that provides scholarships to our members who present their research work at scientific conferences locally and internationally. So far, 6 members have benefited from the scheme, and the scheme is still on. We also established the Pioneer Medical Research Society, PMRS, to coordinate the scholarly endeavors of our members. And the leader of that society happens to be the same person we are celebrating today. I think we should add to that. He's the leader of our Pioneer Medical Research Society. And in September 2021, just in a couple of months, we'll be having our maiden edition of MDCAN's Medical Excellence Award, MEDEXA. So at MEDEXA 2021, we will go further to acknowledge and celebrate our colleagues who are excelling in various aspects of healthcare service delivery. Notwithstanding all this other activism with respect to our professional development, this DMS annual lecture remains our flagship academic event, and our distinguished lecturer we become the first recipient of MDCAN FM Sumwaya Distinguished Medical Specialist Award. A hearty congratulation to Dr. Eninaya. May I use this opportunity to call on the federal government of Nigeria to speedily upgrade FM Sumwaya to a federal teaching hospital. This is because our members have all it takes to provide a robust and high quality medical education to any university medical school or college. The giant infrastructural development we are witnessing in the hospital today is another testimony to the fact that our hospital is ripe for this upgrade. We have in FMC what is comparable to what we have in FMC. What we have in FMC is comparable to what is available in the best teaching hospitals in Nigeria. Kudos to the management of FM Sumwaya, ably led by Professor Azubike Olubuchi. Let me conclude by stating that the DMS annual lecture has come to stay. Our vision is to develop it to a point where delivering a DMS lecture will become a vision of not only medical consultants in FM Sumwaya, but every member of the medical academia. As we listen to today's lecture, may we be inspired to excel professionally and otherwise. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Like the MC said, I'm representing the National President of the Medical and Dental Consultants Association of Nigeria, Professor Ken Ozoyo, who wanted to be here in person. But unfortunately, due to other exigencies of his office, he was unable to make it. He has to be away on a different program. So he asked me to send his apologies. And I'm going to read his speech just the way he wrote it. So this is an address by President Professor Ken Ozoilo, National President MDCAN, on the Maiden Distinguished Specialist Annual Lectures. All protocols duly observed. It gives me great joy and pleasure to be invited to be with you today on this very special occasion of the maiden edition of the Distinguished Medical Specialist Annual Lecture of the Medical and Dental Consultants Association of Nigeria, Federal Medical Center, Umuahia Chapter. The FMC Umuahia is one of the foremost and most vibrant chapters of our association, with very highly credentialed and skilled specialists conducting the very important duties of providing medical services, conducting research and training, just like colleagues in sister institutions across the country. The medical profession in Nigeria today is facing grave challenges. Some of these are specific to the profession, while some are general to the whole country. The socio-economic and political upheavals affecting the country has not spared the medical profession. This has made our practicing environment increasingly hostile, hence the difficulty in resisting the allure of greener pastures, hence the ensuring brain drain that we are observing. Ours is an environment where the work that we do is underappreciated and underremunerated. As if the sacrifice we put on this is not enough, the medical profession has been under the merciless and relentless assault from different quarters in a system that prioritizes paper qualification over knowledge, skills, competence, and output. This is a system that turns a blind eye to the rich historic tradition, to the rich historical tradition, ethics, and peculiarities of the profession that is in line with global best practices. One of the results of this aggression is the increasing discrimination against our fellows over non-possession of the PhD, as evidenced by the convoluted process for the selection of the 9th Vice Chancellor of the Lagos State University, Akoka. Let me assure you that we have obtained a judicial pronouncement on this matter in the case of Professor Uja and NMA versus the University of Jos. And any process to to the contrary from LASU or elsewhere will be subjected to rigorous litigation. More confounding is the acquiescence of the APEX of our APEX postgraduate training body, the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria, to this black bill by the introduction of the controversial MD program, despite widespread opposition from the fellows and also MDCAM. We commend the federal government for increasing the retirement age of consultants and other health workers. We urge expedient action on the implementation of the government salary structure in the university for all clinical lecturers in line with the government circular of 2008. It is one of the absurdities in the country, Nigeria, that while some universities remunerate their clinical lecturers on commerce, others pay them on commerce, even among the federal universities. We also demand that state government should follow suit in implementing these changes as they were stemming the tide of brain drain that is flowing across the country. Despite this, our members across the country have certainly continue to discharge their responsibility at the apex of the structure of clinical practice with knowledge and skills, dedication, efficiency and professionalism. It is safe to say that the fact that our health sector is still functional is in no small measure due to the labor of love of consultants and other health workers across the country. And so to the topic of today's lecture, it is altogether apt. As a distinguished lecturer explores the topic, the prime unpredictable past, preempting and prioritizing the process of professionally, process professionally and proficiently. The lecturer, Dr. Eyinna Nduka, is thoroughbred professional and an erudite scholar. I have no doubt today that we are in for what promises to be a highly educative and entertaining treatise. On behalf of the MDCAM National President, I congratulate you on this speech, epoch-making event. I congratulate most especially all of us who have opted to remain for now to practice our profession within the shores of Nigeria. And I most sincerely commend your patriotism. I urge you to renew your commitment and dedication to the care of the suffering Nigerians. Let me plead that you sustain the noble effort of this lecture, and I pray that future ones will be even more grand. I thank you for your attention.
The chairman of this occasion, Professor Augustine Iwope, sir, with your kind permission, let me respectfully observe protocols established by the MC for want of time. Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Today is really a very important day in the history of Federal Medical Center of Nigeria. I'm sure you all agree with me. And I enjoyed the previous speakers in welcoming all of you to this maiden edition of the Distinguished Specialist Lecture being hosted by MDCAM, the FMC Umuahia branch. The hospital management under my watch has continuously engaged and worked with MDCAM and other professional bodies and unions in the hospital, and will continue to do so. Because if you don't engage, you won't be able to dialogue and solve problems. And that can explain the absolute peace and tranquility observed in our institution. You know, obviously, there will be some Judases, but we will always deal with them when they come. So I can categorically state that I'm part and parcel of the planning process of this program. And also ensure a heat-free venue for the event at no cost to the MDCAM Association. I've also supported in other ways that I won't mention here, because I'm seeing the chairman of NAM looking at me. Because if I say something now, first thing in the morning, I'm in my office. Academic programs. You know that it's something that I encourage, because it's something I like also to participate in. So that is why we conceptualized the colloquium that we're doing. It cuts across all aspects of the hospital. That we do every 3 months, and people join online, and the participation has been wonderful. What we derive from the colloquium is like a kind of feedback from different areas. And I can assure you that once we get those feedbacks, we always want them to improve on what we have been fed back, so that the system will be a functional system, which is why we are here as your management. And today's program is also one of such that you see that we are also supported and encouraged. Just today, just to purchase what we're doing and the effect to have, especially on the consultants who are lecturers with Prague University. I had a meeting with the Vice Chancellor and his team, and obviously with the Head of Clinical Services and our team. And we jointly agreed that all honorary lecturers who are here and who are working with Prague University will be promoted according to how they perform up to the rank of professor. Surprise tomorrow, Don Luca will be up because he's watching him. So I'm encouraging everybody to make sure you publish and make sure you're visible. Because if you're not visible, nobody will recognize you. And Gregory University has also accepted to build a modern lecture hall for 4th MEB students and 5th MEB students inside this hospital. With facilities for library for their students, and of course dorm rooms for the students, so that in the night when they come for things they can do in the night, they can't go back to the hostel. They will sleep there and in the morning they can go back. So in 2 weeks time, when we'll be having a board meeting of the hospital, I will present this to the board for approval. And the VC has assured me that once I get the necessary approvals, the next week the architect will be on ground and work will start. The ways we are trying to make this environment more academic, because it's one of the mandates that the government gave us. Teaching, training of manpower, service delivery, obviously teaching and research, and that is what we are encouraging. Craig Bass, thank you very much, Mr. Vice Chancellor. So without wasting much of your time, and knowing fully well that we have numerous programs lined up for this event, I want to officially welcome you all to this maiden edition of the Distinguished Medical Specialist Annual Lecture, and I encourage you all to participate fully. But please bear in mind that going forward, I did tell them the current chairman that once Dr. Duka has finished his lecture, the hospital management will sew a special robe for him as an applicant that will be a distinguished lecturer here. So any other person that is coming after him will also get this thing. We'll decide the color and everything decided by him. Then the cost of the clinic on management. So I want to also encourage everyone to buy a copy of what he has produced. I'm sure it will take him some money to produce this. Please endeavor to buy a copy. On that note, I want to say welcome to Federal Medical Center of Maya. Do enjoy the rest of the program and may God be with us all. Thank you and God bless.
You can do better than that. You can do better than that. Please, jump those hands forward. Chief Bolton, that's wonderful location. Thank you very much, sir, for that wonderful address.
My wonderful host, the Medical Director of Federal Medical Center, Umuahia, Professor Onyebuchi Azubike. A man I have come to love for being a great pleasure, an innovator, extraordinary visionary, a prime mover, and a talented chief. He is a history maker. The first professor to sit on the seat of the medical director. A memorandum of understanding between the university and Federal Medical Center Umuahia that has now qualified you as a teaching hospital. Distinguished members of the High Court, my able registrar here present, I have to register here, okay? Pastor Ogu and Dr. Uke Onuka, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and honorable members of the Medical and Dental Consultants Association of Nigeria. I want to thank you immensely for this privilege of chairing this epoch-making event. This is the first of its kind in Nigeria, and you have also made another history. As far as we are concerned, you are now members of the academic community. The Bible says that when you walk with the wise, you become wise. When you walk with fools, you become a fool. When you walk with professors, you become a professor. Professor Oyegusi will produce more professors before he steps out of that seat. I give you greetings from Gregory University, a university with a difference, a university that has been adjudged as the fastest growing private university in Nigeria. A university that has committed over 5 billion naira in constructing a 1,000 bed capacity teaching hospital. Will be midwifed by Federal Medical Center Umuahia. As a matter of fact, sir, while we had a management meeting, we decided that we will consult you. You sit down with the provost and other medical experts to go look at that teaching hospital and make sure it fits to your test exactly the way you want it to be. And I assure you that that hospital will have the best of facilities in the whole of Africa. From our council as well, and I want to tell you that this event has its blessing, and this event is indeed a showcase of the knowledge and experience of medical consultants, which we are going to be proud of. Most people think that the only job medical doctors do is treat patients. Yes, they treat patients, including those who are academically deficient. But we know that you do much more than that. You are also intellectual giants. You are teachers, researchers, and people who give their lives for others. I was very attentive when the medical pledge, doctor's pledge was going on. At Gregory University, we believe in high quality medical education. And that's why we have established a College of Medical and Health Sciences, which by God's grace will become the best in the country. To achieve our objective of providing world-class medical education, we are partnered with the Federal Medical Center Umuahia to train our clinical students. This is because we believe that FMC Umuahia has some of the best clinical teachers in this part of the country. As a matter of fact, we had an invitation from FMC Umuahia. They were so much eager to have us, but we said no, we are comfortable with FMC Umuahia. What is happening today confirms that FMC Umuahia consultants are excellent academics. Our university will be glad to partner with the Medical and Dental Consultants Association of Nigeria, FMC Umuahia, to expand the frontiers of clinical and health services research in Abia State. By the way, it may interest you to know that our chancellor has just released 1 billion naira in research endowment in the area of medicine. I know that the provost is, I think, is the chairman of that committee. So those of you who are here,
in FMC who have not been taking research seriously. Now you have the avenue, you have the platform to proceed in the area of research. Make your publications and position yourself for professorial appointments. I want to appreciate the medical director once again for the great job he is doing to transform FMC Moya to a center of medical excellence in the Southeast region and Nigeria at large. I also want to appreciate the leadership and members of MDCAN for conceiving this event. The event is akin to professorial inaugural lectures held in universities.
And I don't know, sir, why you are too fast to take it.
Because you know, we are just about to start our own inaugural lecture in Gregory University in the next month. This man has jumped in the world. I like people who are proactive in their thinking. Sir, God bless you. You have what it takes to be a federal teaching hospital. I must say that. The human resources you have and the infrastructure you have. And we want to assure you, whatever infrastructural facility you need to accomplish your dream, Gregory University will be on hand to help you. We told you our understanding about how to erect a structure here. We will do it. We committed over 650 million naira to set up a pathology block in Amata Specialist Hospital. We will do much more than that in FMC Moya. We assure you, in the next 6 months, the medical and dental consultants will be so proud of the understanding FMC Moya has got into with Gregory University. Because physically, you will see the finger of Gregory University here. The footprints will be made very clear. Let me also congratulate the distinguished medical specialist lecturer, Dr. Nduka Enyima. The topic of your lecture, the prime unpredictable paths, preempting and prioritizing the process professionally and proficiently. It's very catchy. Very, very catchy. I'm a medical biochemist by training. So I think I have a little understanding, but not fully of what he's talking about. But I'm going to sit down here and listen to him. I must say that I'm glad to be part of this event, and I pray God will strengthen you to sustain what you have started. God bless you.
Born to Chief William, Ugonaya, and late Lord, Ezine Uzoma Yunusitibuka, of Ame Lohu. Even in the local government area of Abia State, Nigeria. He had his early primary education at the New Layout Primary School, where he obtained his first school degree certificate in 1981. 5 years later, from the famous Methodist College of Zwakko, he obtained the ordinary level West African School Certificate, and all with excellent grades. Talking about a man who had vision and foresight, his decision to be a doctor, interestingly, was made in primary school. And the decision to be a specialist in secondary school, all before he even put down home to study medicine. This he did in 1995, where he obtained the MBBS degree in flying colors from the very unique University of Port Harcourt, America. He proceeded with his internship in 1996 at the famous University of Nigeria Teaching Hospital, NUU, and thereafter proceeded for the 1 year National Youth Service Corps mandatory event in Ekiti East local government area of present day Ekiti State in Nigeria, 1997. It's on record that he was the only NYSC medical doctor in the local government area and worked very hard to meet the medical needs. Of many people in that rural community, in the rural communities of that state, and farm settlements. In June 1998, immediately after his NYS, he was employed in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Federal Medical Center, Umuahia. It was here that Faith brought him to his mentor, Professor A.E. Anan, who at the time combined the honor status of being the only consultant obstetrician and gynecologist in the hospital and that of the medical director of the hospital. His mentor motivated him maximally and contributed to his success in the primary fellowship examination of both the Nigerian College of Surgeons and the National Postgraduate College of Nigeria, which he passed in 1999, and thereafter proceeded a year later to invite Dr. Faculty University for his residency training. Now, having completed his residency and graduation program with excellent performance, note this, having passed the part 1 in October 2002, 2 years from that day, and part 2 examination in 2004, another 2 years. 4 years is a record time to emerge at the best and fastest fellow in the Department of Professional Professional Disciplinary Studies. Also, the great. Next, a brief summary of his career progression. He's a fellow of the Southern College of Surgeons, the Faculty of Obstetrics and Gynecology, which obtained in April 2004, and a fellow of the International College of Surgeons. He also holds a certificate on good clinical practice from the prestigious University of London. He has 26 years professional experience in the practice of medicine, 23 of which have been specialist experience in obstetrics and gynecology, and he has worked 17 years as a consultant obstetrician in gynecology. In this endeavor, he has undertaken various clinical, academic, teaching, research, and administrative duties, all aimed at improving the health of humanity. He has tutored and mentored undergraduate medical students, postgraduate medical doctors, and other paramedical staff, such as nurses and midwives in the practice of obstetrics, gynecology, reproductive health, family controls, fertility controls with family planning, and have frequently engaged in health promotion activities, advocacy, all aimed at reducing maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality. He is an external examiner to the Abia State University, Uturu, and University of Otago, trainer and examiner in the Faculty of Surgery and Gynecology for both the North African College of Surgeons and the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria. He is a chief consultant of obstetrician and gynecologist, which he has been since 2013 to date, a former head of department for 3 years, pioneer director of the postgraduate studies of Federal Medical Center of Omuahia, 2006 to 2011. Suffice it to say that whatever we are enjoying today as graduates of the program, the foundation was laid by Dr. Dugan. Acting chairman of Medical Advisory Committee and head of clinical services and training, 2008-2011. And currently, he heads the fertility control and family planning units, manages the prevention and mother to child transmission of HIV and AIDS, and has served as the principal investigator of the World Maternal Antifibrinogenic Trial, popularly known as the Human Trial, conducted by the University of London. He's a member of various academic, administrative, and clinical committees in the university. He has trained 25 full specialist obstetricians and gynecologists, one of whom is the one speaking and interpreting to you. And he was the head of department of O&G when the department produced the best rating fellow, not in the southeast of Nigeria, not in Nigeria, but in West African sub-region. He is the treasurer of the Society of Gynecology and Obstetrics of Nigeria, the Abia State branch, and also an honorary lecturer and consultant in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology of Reading University, which is in Nigeria. He has obtained several certificates, including the Quality Healthcare Degree Certificates, Trainer of Trainer Certificates in both postnatal care and breastfeeding in the context of HIV and AIDS. He has a certificate of proficiency in biomedical research from the University of Miami, Florida, and certificate of minimal access surgery. He also has a certificate in the Body of Cancers in Nigeria from the International College of Surgeons and a certificate in prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV. He also has a certificate for his contribution in the Woman Trial previously introduced. He has been involved in different consultancy projects and research. He is the chief consultant of medical consultants and free medical missions from 2013 to date. Anybody who has participated in that mission will agree that it's not a paracetamol and aspirin mission. It's a real free medical mission. He's also a consultant to free medical mission to GDAD Medical Group in the Dakot. Some of his notable achievements, including pioneering the Directorate of Ordinary Studies in Federal Medical Center, Omaha, from 2006 to 2011. He was the best graduating fellow of the African College of Surgeons and Foundation, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, University of Otago in 2004. Best graduating student in biology, physics, geography, and agriculture. So little wonder he was president of the Science Club of Methodist College, in 1986. He rose from class monitor from primary 1 to class 4. Not that he was a beast, but in recognition of his excellent qualities, he was promoted to school monitor a year later, after serving 4 years in that capacity. The one became also sees and was a choir prefect of this college also until 1986. Agric prefect in the same school, 1986. Deputy house prefect in the same school, 1986. He was library prefect in Arts and Science, School of Arts and Science in Aba, 1988.
President of Science School, Federal School of Arts and Science in Aba, also 1988. He presided over the Medical Students Fellowship, University of Port Harcourt in 1995, and the House Officers Doctor's Fellowship, University of Nigeria Teaching Hospital in 1999.
Sorry, it's not very clear. He is a worthy son of Bobo in the community, and for in recognition of his service,
he has been awarded the
prestigious worthy son of Bobo in the community. An Ezina Award from Methodist Church Nigeria. He belongs to several professional,
including the Nigerian Medical Association, Medical and Dental Consultants Association of Nigeria, Society of Gynecology and Obstetrics of Nigeria, International College of Surgeons, Federation International Obstetrics and Gynecology, PIGO, West African College of Surgeons, International Society for Infectious Diseases, Global Stop TB Initiative Organization. He's also a member of some committees, including the Pioneer Research Society, MD Campbell from 2019 to date, Senior Staff Disciplinary Committee, FSU Moya from 2019 to date,
from 2018 to date. He also chairs the Prenatal Mortality Panel of Inquiry, Federal Research and Kalamaya, Editorial Board of the Pioneer Medical Journal of the Medical and Health Association of Nigeria, FSU Moya Chapter, and also a member of the Residency Training Committee. He has attended several conferences and has given several lectures and continued education programs. He has over 20 publications to his credit in reputable international and local journals. He is skillful in computer software like Microsoft Office, Excel, PowerPoint, and statistical packages for social sciences. Now, we are saving the best for the last. Anybody who has ever operated in a program can attest to this, that if there is any student, any man you want to see an emergency, the doctor you want to see. And our students used to tell us that a consultant must never give up. A consultant should never give up. Fight with your last bullet. And that is how he trained us, and I'm proud to be his protagonist. So he's skilled in gynecological and obstetric procedures and surgery. He has performed over 3,000 cesarean sections, over 1,000 myomectomies, over 500 maternal abdominal hysterectomies, over 500 emergency salpingectomies, several vulval, vaginal, cervical, tubal, ovarian, and breast surgeries. He is skilled in family planning procedures, staging laparotomies, and other procedures relevant to obstetrics and gynecology. In all this, he still finds time to sing, read, and play the good things. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you our distinguished lecturer for today, Dr. Elimina Chibembe, who will be the MDPH Equus Fixed Discipline.
Please, while standing, I just received a peculiar information that it happens to be the birthday of Dr. Doka. Before goes on with his lecture this morning, please, wherever you are, I'd like you, I just want to brief you down just to sing a happy birthday song to Dr. Doka. 1, 2.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Doctor, please, while the doctor is giving this lecture, the people at the house, I hope, thank you very much. You can come down so you can see just few persons.
I'm going to talk on the topic, the prime unpredictable paths, preempting and prioritizing the process, professionally and proficiently. As part of the Distinguished Medical Specialist annual lecture, a media event, an inaugural event, the first of its kind, and I'm pleased and happy and delighted to be chosen as the first lecturer in this series. Thank you very much. Next slide. We'll look at this topic under this outline. Next slide. Let's look at the definition of terms. Prime, from the Queen's English Dictionary, prime means first in rank, importance or quality. Predict, to foretell, to state what one believes will happen. Unpredictable, inability to foretell or state that what one believes will happen. Pass, a permit to move from one place to another. For instance, boarding pass. Priority, preference, something requiring special attention. Preempt, to take action, to check other action beforehand. Professional, conforming to the technical or ethical standards of a profession, earning a living in a field often engaged by amateurs, having a specified occupation as a permanent career. Proficient, skilled, competent. Looking at the story and stages of a journey by air, for you to undertake a journey by air, you have to book your flight, pay for the flight, prepare, pack your bag, luggage, and then you get to the airport, get your boarding pass, and pass through some security checks. Then you board your aircraft, and then you take all the necessary precautions as directed for takeoff. And after that, you take off. And you know how takeoff can be. For so many people, their heart rate will go up, their blood pressure will go up. Everywhere is not settled. Some will even start vomiting. It's not easy. But after takeoff, after some time, you start cruising. The airplane stabilizes, and you can open your laptop and start doing your research. And you'll be calmed down with a lot of things to eat, tea or coffee, this or that. For those of you who board all the important aircrafts, you enjoy the cruising session. It's as if you're on land. There's no anxiety. Whereas you're thousands of miles up in the air, thousands of feet up in the air. So after cruising comes the landing, another stress. You know, it's as if your whole body is shaking. You know, the ENT surgeons will tell us the changes in the pressure. Your ear will start giving you some tingling sensations, and then the aircraft will be descending, penetrating through the clouds, having all the bumps as if it's a vehicle on the road, in Nigerian road. After that, then you land, and some people will sing hallelujah. But it doesn't stop at that. You need to collect your luggage and then pass through another security check. Make sure that you're not bringing in things that your visiting country doesn't allow, you know. And then some security checks can be very hectic when dogs come to sniff a human being and check all sorts of things. And these days of coronavirus, in fact, some people may not even exit from the airport immediately. They may be shown somewhere to go and quarantine. So it's not an easy thing. But after all that, you exit the airport and then get to your destination. By introduction, fusion of the male and female gametes is the core event in reproduction. Genetic material in the two haploid gametes, the ovum and the spermatozoon, combines to produce a diploid zygote at fertilization. Fertilization in mammals occurs in the female genital tract and is followed by implantation of the embryo and development of the fetus in the uterus. The first and most important permit to move from one point to another is given to the diploid zygote at fertilization, the prime pass. However, it is difficult to foretell if and how the journey by the zygote will progress or proceed, the prime unpredictable pass. There is therefore the need to take action, to check other action beforehand, preempting, and give specified attention and preference, prioritizing to the process with great expertise professionally and in a skilled and competent manner, proficiently. Before you attend this prime class, there are some fertility issues that affect attainment of this prime pass. Abnormalities in any of the underlisted processes required to achieve pregnancy, like ovulation, competent oocyte, fallopian tube patency, normal uterine cavity and vagina, spermatogenesis, coitus, fertilization, embryo implantation. Also, the prime pass cannot be achieved because of some things that can cause infertility. In brief, primary infertility is contributed majorly by male factor, 25%, and unexplained factors, whereas secondary infertility is contributed mainly by tubuperitoneal factors. Next slide, please. Also, we have age-related decline in fertility that can affect this prime pass. Delaying childbirth is associated with worse reproductive outcomes, with more infertility, miscarriages, chromosomal abnormalities, and medical comorbidities, and increase in maternal and fetal mobility and mortality. The age at first birth is increasing because of career. Everybody wants to go to school. Why not? School is so important, and that's why we all gathered here in our beautiful robes. In Calabar, age at first birth is 25 to 29 years. In the UK, 30 years. In a rural northern Nigerian community, age at first birth was found to be 16 years. Desired family size and unwired from the work we did, we found that desired family size is 4 children. No mother wanted to have just one child. The range was between 2 and 6. Nobody wanted to be childless, and nobody wanted to just, part with just a child. The minimum was 2 children, and the maximum was 6 in the study we did. Assisted reproductive technology affects the acquisition of those prime pairs. In this day and age, increase in vitro fertilization, embryo transfer, pregnancy rates has affected pregnancy such that in the US, for instance, over 2% of all babies born each year are IVF babies. And so we may go ahead and, store the embryo to use after so many years. In Nigeria, the number of IVF embryo transfer babies is on the increase. In our hospital here in FMC Umuahia, our hospital is the only government hospital in Nigeria operating at an advanced level in assisted reproductive technology and about completing a massive modern IVF center. A big kudos to our able and dynamic medical director and the team. Contraceptive uptake also reduced pregnancy rates. In our hospital, from the work we did, several work we've done over the years, copper intrauterine contraceptive device is the commonest long-lasting contraceptive method used in our hospital by our clients. Whereas voluntary surgical contraception, tubal ligation and vasectomy is the least known method and also the least utilized method. Let's get to take off and the first stage of our journey. Having observed all the protocols, we are ready for takeoff. The first week of embryonic development. Day one, like we said, is fertilization. Day two is the 2-cell stage. Day three is the morula. Day four is early blastocyst. Day five, late blastocyst. Day 6-7, implantation of blastocyst commences. By the second week, we have development of the bilaminar germ disc. Days 8-10, implantation of blastocyst continues. Days 11 and 12, blastocyst is completely embedded in the endometrial stroma. By day 13, the surface defect in the endometrium has usually sealed. Bleeding at implantation site may occur and may be confused with normal menses since it's around the 28th day of the cycle. Some pre and post implantation reproductive failures occur, and they occur often. 10-15% of fertilized ovum start cleavage but fail to implant. Of those that eventually implant, only 58% survive until the second week. And 16% of those are abnormal. Hence, when the first expected menstrual menstruation is missed, only 42% of eggs exposed to sperm are surviving. But some will abort in subsequent years and some will be abnormal at the time of birth. Next slide. Third week to eighth week is the embryonic period. It's the period of embryogenesis or organogenesis. This is when most organs of the body are formed, the ectoderm, the mesoderm, the endoderm, germ layers. They give rise to their tissues and organs. Many cross structural birth defects are induced at this stage. But unfortunately, the mother may not realize she's pregnant this critical time, especially during the third and fourth weeks, which are very vulnerable. Consequently, she may not avoid teratogens like cigarettes, smoke, alcohol, harmful drugs, and other things. Next slide, please. This shows the sensitivity to teratogens. The sensitivity is not usually sensitive within the first 2 weeks, but from the third to the eighth week, that's the period you have the period of greatest sensitivity to teratogens. And that's when so many congenital abnormalities begin to form. Next. You see that the peak is around fourth and fifth week. Next slide, please. The journey of the fetus continues. After fertilization, the next thing is implantation. Unfortunately, many fertilized diploid zygotes, implant outside the uterine cavity. And that gives us what we call ectopic pregnancy. It occurs in about 2% of pregnancies. They implant commonly at the tube in 99% of cases. You can also implant in the abdomen, in the intestines, on the ovary, or even inside the uterus, but at the cervix or angular areas. Ectopic pregnancy is a very important entity. When it's ruptured, especially if it occurs at the instanteal area, that's where you have a lot of muscles, you know, just before the entry into the uterine cavity, a lot of muscles are there. If it ruptures there, it tends to occur with a lot of torrential hemorrhage that is very life-threatening. And in fact, it's put as the number one, next slide, as the number one killer, the leading pregnancy-related cause of death in first trimester due to massive intrabdominal hemorrhage when it's ruptured. Salpingectomy for a ruptured ectopic pregnancy is the commonest major gynae surgery done in FMCY. The most important thing to do here is early detection and prompt treatment of ectopic pregnancy. And in the modern age, we use serum pregnancy test levels and transvaginal ultrasound. Combine the two to know the best thing to do for the woman. The use of quantitative HCG levels, which are above the level you will expect for intrauterine gestation, below the level you expect for intrauterine gestation, and transvaginal ultrasound does not show any intrauterine pregnancy, gives you a high index of suspicion. And you need to intervene when you have high index of suspicion, because it's better you intervene than to allow the pregnant mother with ectopic pregnancy to die from bleeding. So the best way to diagnose ectopic pregnancy is to rule out intrauterine pregnancy. And the quantitative HCG level above which all intrauterine pregnancies are visible by transvaginal ultrasound is defined as a discriminatory zone. Next slide, please. Next slide. In our hospital, gynecological surgeries in FMCY revealed that salpingectomy for ectopic pregnancy accounted for 34.4% last year, 2020, and that was the commonest indication for all our major gynae surgeries. Next slide. Emergency contraception terminates the journey of this poor fertilized ovum. In a very early age, some people use emergency contraception to nip the pregnancy in the bud. The best method is use of copper IUCD. Oral ones can be used estrogen or progesterone or progesterone only or a combination. Next slide, please. Next slide. Then comes the abortion. Abortion makes this journey very unpredictable. Someone has gotten pregnant, and all along the line, the person begins to miscarry. Abortion, another name for abortion is miscarriage. Actually, we use miscarriage to connote spontaneous abortion. And then, we also have induced abortion. Abortion is termination of pregnancies before the age of viability, before 28 weeks in our country. In developed countries, before 24 weeks. The incidence is such that 50% of all conceptions end in spontaneous abortion. 50% of those abortuses have major chromosomal abnormalities. Most common ones are listed there. But abortion, like I said, is broadly classified into spontaneous and induced. Induced abortion is further classified into safe and unsafe. It's safe when it's done in a hygienic environment by trained personnel. It's unsafe when those conditions are not met. Next slide. The clinical types of abortion could be threatened, complete, incomplete, missed, or inevitable, or septic. The risk of miscarriage is 15% at 6 weeks or more, and it's 15% after first miscarriage. It gets to as high as 31% after the second miscarriage, and can get to as high as 46% after the third miscarriage. The spontaneous abortions are a natural means of screening embryos for defects, reducing the incidence of congenital abnormalities. You know, we have a God, and our God is a good God. He will not allow you to give birth to children with two heads or children that have terrible defects. So most of those children with congenital malformations or chromosomal abnormalities, they get miscarried, and we get consoled by that. Without this phenomenon, approximately 12% instead of 2.3% of infants will have birth defects. You can imagine how the world would be if not for God trying to prove what he has started. Molecular screening of embryos for genetic defects is done using combination of IVF and polymerase chain reaction. The etiology of abortion is more in advanced maternal age and those who have chromosomal abnormalities and uterine abnormalities and other illnesses, and also in cervical insufficiency. That's when the mouth of the womb is weak and cannot carry pregnancies beyond a particular point. You can imagine what congenital abnormality we are showing here. This is ectopia cordis. This child's heart is outside. The heart is not inside the thoracic cavity, it's outside, due to failure of the ventral wall to close. Next slide. And this child, the intestines are outside because of the same failure of the ventral wall to close. Next slide. In Umwayam, we've discovered, just as is known globally, that uterine fibroids cause recurrent miscarriages. And this is a huge uterine fibroid we harvested here in Umwayam. It's 5.5 kg from a nulliparous lady who has had several miscarriages. Next slide. And this is another even bigger one harvested here in Umuahia, a giant uterine fibroid weighing 7.5 kg from another nulliparous lady who has had several miscarriages. Next slide. The common indications for gynae admissions in FMC Umuahia. Abortion is the commonest. Abortion accounted for 25.2% of all admissions into our gynecological ward in the year 2020. Next slide. We also come to multifetal gestation, multiple pregnancy. Multiple pregnancy, we have higher risk for the fetus and the mother than in singleton pregnancies. Usually, multiple pregnancy is due to fertilization of two separate ova when you have dizygotic or fraternal twins. These ones occur in about 2/3 of all multiple pregnancies. It may also arise from a single fertilized ovum that subsequently divides. This is where we have identical twins, monozygotic or identical twins. If division occurs within the first 72 hours after fertilization, it gives rise to two embryos, two amnions, and two chorions, and a diamnionic, dichorionic twin pregnancy evolves. Two distinct placenta or a single fused placenta may develop. But divisions between the fourth day and the eighth day gives rise to a diamnionic monochorionic twin pregnancy. By approximately the eighth day after fertilization, the chorion and the amnion have already differentiated, and division results in two embryos within a common amnion sac. That is monoamnionic monochorionic twin pregnancy. Conjoint twins result if twinning is initiated later. Two theories exist. And after, the baby could split into two, or a part of a baby can fuse into another one. Next slide. Nigeria ranks first in the incidence of twin pregnancy worldwide. And this is noted in Yoruba tribe, where the presence of clomiphene-like substance in amala, their staple food, is thought to be responsible for that. Problems of twin gestation abound. There could be spontaneous reduction via miscarriage, where some fetuses are spontaneously miscarried. There could also be multifetal reduction, which is consciously done by the doctor to make sure that the woman doesn't become a mouse or a rat that will give birth to 20 or 12 children. There could be selective reduction in cases of too many fetuses. There could be selective termination if any of the fetuses is not growing well and is not fit. Next slide. Part of the problems of twin pregnancy is what we call twin-twin transmission syndrome, where blood leaves one twin, the donor twin, who becomes pale, and then gets to the recipient twin, who becomes plethoric. We also have a problem of discordant twins, where one twin weighs over 25 to 30% more than the other, like cheating the other one. And then we could have death of a co-twin, two twins and one is dead. It's a big problem that needs to be managed by professionals in a professional and proficient way. We could have congenital abnormalities in one twin, which may affect the other twin, and eventually lead to the death of that twin, or cause preterm delivery for the twin. We have difficulties in vaginal delivery of the second twin. The first twin escapes most times, but the second twin, quite more frequently, may have problem of delivery. We manage the case that the lady delivered her first twin in Uzagu in a health center, and they tried everything possible to deliver the second twin, and they couldn't. They had to transport the lady all the way to Umuahi, and we delivered the second twin 8 hours after the delivery of the first twin. In fact, by the time they got to our hospital, the baby was already having what we call fetal distress. It was about time, so we had to do emergency cesarean section to deliver that second twin. These are examples of conjoint twins. This twin joined at the thorax, call it thoracophagus. The other one joined at the back, pyrophagus. This joined at the head, craniophagus. And then this one is dicephalous twin, has two heads. Let's go to the next slide. In the journey of the fetus, a lot of interruptions happen. Febrile illness in pregnancy makes the journey unpredictable. Malaria is the chief. Malaria causes hyperpyrexia, hyperparathyroidism, anemia, and can affect the mother in such a way that it could lead to miscarriages, preterm deliveries, stillbirths, congenital malaria, low birth weight, prematurity, or even intrauterine growth restriction. Next slide. But we take precaution. We make sure that every pregnant woman is properly treated for malaria. Whether the person exhibits the symptoms or not, we treat prophylactically. We treat two or three times before the woman delivers. And we encourage them to use insecticide-treated mosquito nets judiciously. We have cases of cerebral malaria, black water fever, and all in pregnancy. Because the pregnant mother has lower immunity, so malaria tends to be exaggerated in pregnant mother. We also have another major cause of febrile illness in pregnancy, urinary tract infection. Anatomic and physiologic changes in pregnancy put the pregnant woman at greater risk of urinary tract infection. So at first visit to our antenatal clinic, we always do urinalysis, microscopic culture and sensitivity to make sure that if they have urinary tract infection, we treat them. There could be asymptomatic bacteria where the woman will have urinary tract infection but with no symptoms at all. You could have acute retritis, you could have cystitis. Then the worst of them all is acute pyelonephritis. Next slide. Next slide. Acute pyelonephritis is a big danger. The symptoms and signs include fever, chills, back pain, nausea, vomiting, preterm contractions, and preterm labor. The complications may include bacteremia, septic shock, pulmonary edema, respiratory distress syndrome, renal dysfunction, preterm labor, chorioamnionitis. Treatment is preferably as inpatient. We admit the patient, give intravenous fluids, give intravenous antibiotics until patient is afebrile for 24 to 48 hours, and then follow with the sensitive oral antibiotics for 7 to 10 days. Next slide. Lack of response to treatment should prompt radiologic evaluation for abscess or renal stone. We have other infectious diseases in pregnancy that cause febrile illness, HIV. Prevention of mother to child transmission of HIV, antenatal and PMTCT, has helped a lot to save our fetuses along their journey. We have the touches infection, toxoplasmosis, rubella, cytomegalovirus, herpes, syphilis. These infections can cause a lot of congenital abnormalities for the innocent fetus and can impact very negatively on the pregnant mother. We have the group B streptococcus. In this, it can cause sepsis in the newborn. Hence, vaginal and rectal cultures from the mothers at 35 to 36 are done, and antibiotics prophylaxis is given. We have the parvovirus, we have intestinal hemiptiasis. From the studies done in our department, we discovered that intestinal hemiptiasis is not uncommon and is a major cause of problems for our women. We also have other infections like COVID-19, which has been proven to manifest in a more severe way in pregnant women than in non-pregnant women and warrant intensive care admissions. We have the Zika virus. Thank God it's not in our environment, it's mainly in America. So pregnant women are advised not to go to endemic areas and also to avoid people from endemic areas and to avoid sexual contact with people from endemic areas. Anemia in pregnancy impacts very negatively to the journey of our fetus. It may cause spontaneous abortion, preterm labor, intrauterine growth restrictions, unexplained fetal demise. The commonest form is iron deficiency anemia. We also have the folate and B12 deficiency, and as well as the thalassemias. Next slide. The fetus does not suffer iron deficiency anemia because the normal transfer from the mother to the fetus is not affected. Additional 1,000 milligrams of elemental iron is needed in pregnancy. Iron and folic acid supplementation are routinely given in pregnancy. Women don't joke with their routine drugs and is a way of making sure they don't get anemic. Diabetes impacts negatively in this journey. It affects 2-3% of all pregnancies. 90% of diabetes is gestational, which the onset occurs in the pregnancy, and by the 6th week postpartum, usually it resolves. Pregnancy serves a diabetogenic state. Next slide. The fetal complications abound: miscarriage, unexplained fetal death, congenital malformations, especially the sacral agenesis or caudal regression syndrome. You could have spinal bifida, anencephaly, ventricular septal defect, situs inversus. And preexisting mortality is 2-5% with insulin therapy. But without insulin therapy, it's as high as 65%. So management of diabetes in pregnancy is a multidisciplinary approach where we involve the dietitian, the endocrinologist, the pediatrician, and then they co-manage with the obstetrician to give us the best result. Next slide. Management of diabetes, like I said, is multidisciplinary. We'll make sure that we screen for those congenital abnormalities both in the first trimester using our ultrasound scan, and the second trimester we do the same, and we monitor the fetus very closely. We do our normal scan, do fetal echocardiography. Next slide. In third trimester, we assess for fetal well-being using kick counts from 28 weeks, non-strength testing or biophysical profile at 2 weeks or less, and then ultrasound is done every 4 to 6 weeks. The delivery is decided after lung maturity is ascertained. Next slide. The pregnant woman is at very high risk, like I said, but the risk factors are quite obvious. But when we detect those risk factors, we take decisive steps to make sure that she doesn't have a poor fetal or maternal outcome. Next slide. The oral glucose tolerance test is used for diagnosis of gestational diabetes. The chemical pathologists know all the grammar. I'll let me not bother you. Next slide. We have the rhesus isoimmunization. In this entity, the pregnant mother that is rhesus negative, blood group rhesus negative, if she's carrying a baby that has rhesus positive blood group, immunological responses begin to happen. The mother now forms antibodies against the baby's red cells, and those antibodies begin to destroy the baby's red cells and gets the baby anemic, gets the baby plethoric, baby develops swollen abdomen, baby can eventually die. But thank God, we have program which can prevent such immunological responses, especially and only in non-sensitized women or women who have received enough doses. Because if you give suboptimal doses, the problem will still occur. And then the treatment must be given within 72 hours of exposure. Next slide. The modern day technology has helped us using Doppler ultrasound. Doppler ultrasound can measure the peak middle cerebral artery velocity. The rate of flow in the middle cerebral artery of the fetus can give us an idea of how anemic that fetus is. And then we'll be able to do intrauterine transfusion, give the baby blood inside the womb, and give as many times as possible by time to see the best time to deliver the baby. Unlike previously, where you use amniocentesis and the bilirubin level in the amniotic fluid plotted on Lily chart to know what to do. Next slide. We're entering the sweet part of our journey, which is the cruising part. So very soon you're going to be testing some tea or coffee and all. Next slide. Intrauterine fetal death. So many things can just snuff off the life of a fetus when the fetus should be enjoying all the provisions of this cruising period. In 25 to 40% of cases, it could be fetal causes, where you have chromosomal abnormalities, non-chromosomal birth defects, non-immune hydrops. In 25 to 35% is due to placental causes. And placental abruption is the most common single identifiable cause of fetal death. Other causes include fetal-maternal hemorrhage, premature rupture of membranes, cord accidents. We've done some work on cord accidents. Then placental insufficiency, intrapartum asphyxia, placental previa, twin-twin transition syndrome, chorion gonadotropin. Next slide. Maternal causes account for 5 to 10% of cases, and these are due to hypertensive disorders, diabetes, thyroid disease, renal disease. And then 15 to 35% of causes are unexplained. The ones that are reviewed are for you and I. The ones that are not reviewed, they are entirely in the hands of God. Even the reviewed ones are entirely in His hands. But the unreviewed ones are 100% entirely in His hands. The management of intrauterine fetal death. History is very important. History of risk factors. Intrauterine fetal death must be diagnosed with ultrasound scan. echocardiography can be very misleading, as the heart rate tracing of an anxious mother is usually identical to that of the fetus that is under distress. Postmortem examination is the most important of all investigations offered to parents, for it may be the only source of information about the cause of the fetal death. Antepartum fetal surveillance should be commenced at less than 32 weeks in subsequent pregnancies. Subsequent pregnancies of anybody who has had intrauterine fetal death is regarded as high-risk pregnancy, because we tend to label her as bad obstetric history, and we monitor her very, very carefully to make sure that events of the past don't repeat themselves. Next slide. We're getting to the end, the landing and the last stage of our journey, labor and delivery. Labor is defined as the whole process of childbirth, characterized by regular, strong, purposeful uterine contractions, leading to progressive effacement and dilation of the cervix and descent of the presenting parts, and eventual delivery of the baby and the placenta. Next slide. The safe passage of the fetus through the pelvis is dependent less on absolutes and more upon series of unknown variables that include cervical remodeling, efficiency of uterine contractions, flexibility of the bony and ligamentous pelvis, molding of the fetal head, and adaptability of the fetus physiology. The prime unpredictable path is further highlighted during labor by these unknown variables. We have stages of labor. The first stage is the cervical stage. It's the time to attain full cervical dilatation of 10 centimeters. And this first stage is divided into two phases, the latent phase and the active phase. In the latent phase, the cervix opens up to 3 centimeters. It can last quite long. In nonapare, it could be up to 20 hours with a median of 8 to 6 hours. In multipare, it could be as long as 14 hours with a median of 5 to 3 hours. Actually, the time of onset of labor is not so easy to determine in our environment. Then the active phase of labor is when the mouth of the womb has opened up to 4 centimeters. From 4 centimeters to 10 centimeters is the active phase of labor. In this phase, everything moves fast. And for the non-empowering, we expect that cervical dilatation should be going at the rate of not less than 1.2 centimeters per hour. And in multipare, not less than 1.5 centimeters per hour. Causes of poor progress in first stage could be due to inefficient contraction, the power of labor, or inadequate pelvis, the passage, or due to malposition, malpresentation, or macrosomia emanating from the passenger. Assessment of necessary actions is taken in the first stage of labor. If there is poor progress, you must take a good history and review the fetal maternal signs and check your cardiotomogram, check for lack of color. If there's any meconium staining, fresh meconium staining will tend to suggest fetal distress. You check if the mother has adequate hydration, because dehydration can impact negatively on the progress of labor. Also, if the mother is in so much pain, it might impact negatively. So you give analgesia where necessary. And you do vaginal examination to ascertain if there is caput molding. You check for the position of the head, the station of the fetal head, and interventions are given as necessary, including rehydration, like I said, analgesia, amniotomy, oxytocin infusion may be used in active phase. And serial section could be done when it's indicated. In the second stage of labor, it is called the pelvic stage. It is the time from 10 centimeters cervical ulcer dilatation to the delivery of the baby. It also has two phases, the propulsive phase, when the presenting part descends, and the expulsive phase, when the fetus is expelled. The duration is 2 hours, but it's longer in non-epare. It's actually, most times, it lasts between 20 to 40 minutes. But if it lasts up to 1 hour, you should start taking action. You don't wait and fold your hands for 2 hours. Women may deliver in supine position, in squatting, standing, or in all fours. The totemic position is required for frontal deliveries. Next slide. Description of normal second stage level. When the mother is bearing down, we use one of our hands to cover the ends with a pad and also to support the perineum, while the other hand is used to maintain flexion on the head of the baby to prevent sudden deflection and to control rate of delivery of the head, preventing its rapid delivery and minimizing tears. Episiotomy may be given at crowning of the head. It is not compulsory, it's only given when necessary. Next slide. With the next contraction, gentle traction guides the head towards the perineum until the anterior shoulder is delivered under the subpubic arch. Gentle traction upwards and anteriorly helps deliver the posterior shoulder and the remainder of the trunk. Then we do our we clamp the cord double. Double clamp the cord and cut it between clamps, and then apply a gentle control cord traction to deliver the placenta. That's taking us to the third stage of labor. So the third stage of labor is the time it takes after the delivery of the baby to the delivery of the placenta. The duration is 30 minutes, but most placenta will be delivered within 5 minutes. And if after 5 minutes nothing happens, you should begin to do something. Empty the bladder, rub up contraction, give oxytocin. You try to deliver that placenta, because if it's not delivered, it leads to torrential bleeding, postpartum hemorrhage. So active management of third stage consists of use of uterotonics, early clamping and cutting of the cord, control cord traction, and this has shown to reduce the rate of postpartum hemorrhage greater than 1,000 mL, reduce mean blood loss and postnatal anemia, and also reduce the length of third stage as well as the need for blood transfusion. The first stage of labor is 1 hour after delivery of the placenta. You leave the woman in the delivery unit for observation and monitoring of vital signs. And at this stage, you could initiate breastfeeding, repair any episiotomy that is given, and you give prophylactic oxytocin to prevent postpartum hemorrhage. Next slide. Components of labor, power, passage, and passenger. The power is the contraction, and is the only component that can truly be manipulated, still making our process a bit vague and unpredictable. Regular contractions are needed. Frequency of 3 to 4 contractions in 10 minutes and strong contractions that are more than 200 multivideo units, and then sustained contraction that lasts for at least 40 to 50 seconds. The passenger, the fetus. The fetus presents the part that is overlying the pelvic inlet, we call it the presentation, and at term, up to 95% of fetuses present normally with the head. Only 3.5% will present with the buttocks, bridge, and some will present with the shoulder, others with the cord, and sometimes some will present with more than one presentation, compound presentation. The position is the relationship of the denominator of the fetal parts to fixed points on the maternal pelvis. The markers for position are occiput for vertex presentation, sacrum for bridge, mentum for face, acromion for shoulder. The designated fetal body points in relation is related to the maternal pelvis, either right, left, anterior, posterior, or transverse. Mouth position is any position other than right, left, or direct occipital anterior position. Any position that's not within these three entities, right, left, or direct occipital anterior, is described as mouth position. A mouth position presents larger diameter and can cause longer and difficult labors and lead to more operative deliveries. With effective uterine contraction, mouth position will correct to normal position with flexion of the head at the atlanto-occipital joint of the fetus and rotation forwards. Next, in the passage, is only the gynecoid pelvis that is favorable for childbearing. It's the most common and is the best suited for childbearing. Has wide pubic arch, strength side wall, curved sacrum, non-prominent ischial spines. The android, the anthropoid, and the platyloid are not as favorable. Next slide. The mechanism of normal level delivery. In this landing process, a lot of things happen. At the initial stage, the head will be floating in the pelvis. This is before engagement, as shown in this diagram. Next slide. And then after engagement comes descent. The head descends further and then flexes. Next slide. After flexion comes internal rotation. The head rotates internally by the powerful forces of the muscles, the perineal muscles, help the head to rotate internally. After internal rotation, we have the extension. Extension, because the vulva is directed upwards and outwards, the head follows suit and extends upwards and outwards. Next slide. And through extension, you can get to a stage where we call crowning. At crowning, the head doesn't go back. It just stays there. It's like the woman is wearing a crown and it's the baby's head. Doesn't recede, doesn't come out. And at that stage, if you sense that the perineum is at risk of tearing, especially if it's at risk of tearing towards the rectal mucosa, you need to give episiotomy. Then after extension comes our restitution. The head is delivered and the body begins to rotate after delivery such that the occiput is in line with the fetal spine. After restitution is external rotation. The shoulders align themselves in an anterior posterior fashion so that they could be delivered, not in a transverse fashion, not in an anterior posterior fashion, so that they could be delivered. Next slide. And then comes the delivery of the anterior shoulder, which occurs by lateral flexion of the trunk posterior. Next is the delivery of the posterior shoulder by lateral flexion of the trunk, and then the rest of the body follows. The matrix of labor has been highlighted. Next slide. Next slide. The key point is the minimum of labor. The pathogram is a graphic representation of events in labor. It is made up of the cervical gram, the maternal and the fetal observations. The fetal heart rate is monitored every 15 minutes, contractions every 30 minutes, maternal pulse hourly, while blood pressure, temperature, and urinalysis are checked for hourly, normally. But in a woman that has hypertension, of course, you have to check it more frequently. And then vaginal examination is done for hourly. Well, there are instances where we have to do more frequently. The alarm line is a line drawn on the cervical gram with a slope of 1 cm per hour, which is the ideal progress of labor. While the WHO action line is drawn 4 hours from the alarm line. When the progress of labor crosses the alarm line to the right of it, there is need to review the patient meticulously. Oxytocin augmentation improves rates of cervical dilatation in cases of primary dysfunctional labor, and also in cases of secondary arrest. Next slide. But doesn't necessarily lead to good maternal or fetal outcome. So that you're having good contraction does not mean that you're going to have very good outcome. Continuous professional support in labor reduces operative interventions and the need for pain relief, shortens labor, and leads to better fetal outcome. Continuous professional support is provided by professionals. Could be midwives, could be gynecologists, but it has to be somebody that is trained in the act of delivery. So men staying with the woman during labor has been seen to impact very positively on the outcome of labor. Delivery by cesarean section is an appropriate intervention after a full assessment and should not be regarded as a failure. In our environment, people say it's not my portion. Please, if you need to deliver your baby safely only by cesarean section, it is your portion. Instrumental vaginal delivery may be challenging after correction of poor progress in labor and should only be performed by experienced practitioners. Like I said, poor progress could be corrected. Oxytocin could be given, contractions could be strong. The lady might attain full cervical dilatation of 10 centimeters, but it doesn't mean that the journey has completed. So in straighter vaginal delivery, it may still have to be done using vacuum or forceps. The woman trial is a world trial, the World Maternal Anti-Fibrillation Trial that FMC Moya was opportuned to be part of. And by God's grace, I was the principal investigator. And this trial evaluated the use of tranexamic acid in the control of, in the prevention and treatment of primary postpartum hemorrhage. And tranexamic acid has been proven to be very beneficial. And now it's being used more than before. Birth injuries tend to put a lot of problems to this journey of our fetus. The incidence of birth injuries, luckily, has reduced since the elimination of difficult forceps delivery and better management of breech delivery. Birth injuries on the head could cause spontaneous intracranial hemorrhage, intraventricular hemorrhage, cephalohematoma. On the nerves, it could cause spinal cord injury, dislocation of the fractures of the fetal vertebrae. It could cause brachial plexopathy, EPS or Duchenne paralysis, Plumpkin paralysis, fascicity of the arm and legs, Horner syndrome, next slide, facial nerve paralysis. On the skeleton and the muscles, it could cause fractures of the clavicle, humerus, femur, mandible, skull, sternocleidomastoid muscle, could be injured and be unable to do his work well, such that the head of the baby tilts to one side, like the head of the tortoise. That's called torticollis. We have congenital birth defects, like Amion-Barth syndrome, the congenital postural deformities like the talipes, aquinovarus, clubfoot, scoliosis, hip dislocation, and hypoplastic lungs. Next slide. Largely unpredictable peripartum obstetric emergencies that require well-rehearsed management protocols for prompt intervention include sudden maternal collapse. These are things that you can't predict easily, but they occur, and they are the things that kill our women most. Sudden maternal collapse could be caused by obstetric causes like massive obstetric hemorrhage, placenta previa abruption, placenta, postpartum hemorrhage, primary postpartum hemorrhage, uterine inversion. It could be due to severe preeclampsia with intracranial hemorrhage. It could be due to eclampsia. It could be due to amniotic fluid embolism, neurogenic shock, surgical complications, severe sepsis, or cardiac failure due to peripartum cardiomyopathy. The medical causes include massive pulmonary embolism, cardiac failure, myocardial infarction, and even cerebral infarction. The management requires calling for help and applying the ABCDE of resuscitation and then instituting definitive management. Next slide. Shoulder dystocia is another largely non-predictable obstetric emergency where the baby's head is born and the shoulders refuse to come out. Next slide. Sometimes we may have to replace the head into the vagina. When we have tried all the maneuvers and they fail, we replace the head into the vagina and then go from the abdomen and perform an emergency operating delivery. We call it abdominal rescue to be able to deliver that baby. Next slide. Just still on the previous slide, we have syphysiotomy. The act of syphysiotomy is not so easy, but I have one of my very beautiful, handsome, gentleman colleague in this hall, Dr. Kali, is well skilled in doing syphysiotomy. And we'll work together and we'll work together in my early days at Matafi. So, Reverend Sister Dr. Tumi actually taught us a lot of skills. But he is chief to some of them, because I was just a small doctor there. Amniotic fluid embolism is one condition that is not predictable, not preventable, and rapidly progressing. Thank God it's rare, but it's often fatal. It causes maternal death within 10 minutes to 32 hours of onset and can cause permanent neurologic sequelae in up to 85% of survivors. The management requires rapid cardiopulmonary resuscitation and admission into intensive care units under multidisciplinary senior inputs, not multidisciplinary junior inputs. This one is multidisciplinary senior impute. We are consultants in those specialties: anesthesiologists, respiratory physicians, obstetricians who come brainstorm and know what to do. In fact, delivery within 5 minutes of cardiac arrest is recommended to facilitate cardiopulmonary resuscitation of the mother. Cord prolapse is another entity that is largely unpredictable. Largely unpredictable. The cord prolapses below the presenting part after the membranes are ruptured. And the cord is at risk of compression as well as vasospasm due to change in temperature. So the management has to be very, very fast. You deliver the baby through the fastest possible route. But before then, you do the necessary resuscitative things to prevent further cord compression. You keep the woman in knee chest position. You fill the bladder with 500 mils of normal saline and clamp it. You could raise the hip of the bed with pillows so that there will be no impact on the cord from the presenting part. And then you prevent spasm by using warm saline to wrap the cord and gently put the cord back into the vagina and until you are able to do your definitive delivery. Topolytics may also be helpful. In FMC-Umaya, this table 4 shows us deliveries in FMC-Umaya among booked and unbooked patients. We had a total of 1,553 deliveries in 2020 and 1,610 deliveries in 2019. Maybe COVID-19 is responsible for the lower rate in 2020. And then our C-section rate among booked patients was 37.5% in 2019. And in 2020, among booked patients was 37.7%. And these percentages are appreciable considering the global data. Next slide. The birth order analysis in FMC-Umaya revealed that singleton pregnancies delivered in 2020 were 1,502. Twins were 52. And triplets, 4. No quadruplets. Total deliveries came to 1,618. And the twinning rate among our clients was 32.1%. Next slide. Indications for cesarean section in FMC-Umaya. The commonest indication for cesarean section in 2020, even in 2019, was one previous cesarean section plus an obstetric indication. The next was two previous cesarean sections or more. If a woman has had two previous cesarean sections or more, we always deliver her by cesarean section so that we don't risk her rupturing her womb and dying from hemorrhage. Next slide. Procedures done in our maternity theater in FMC-Umaya. We did a total of 612 cesarean sections in 2020. We did 3 cesarean sections with bilateral tubal ligation. We did emergency laparotomy for uterine rupture, 1. And the emergency laparotomy for uterine rupture without bilateral tubal ligation in 11 cases. On the whole, we did a total of 630 procedures in our maternity theater. Next slide. Pregnancy outcome, fetal outcome, 2020. We have live births, total live births of 1,545, total stillbirth of 125. But if you look at our booked and unbooked data, you discover that unbooked patients constituted only 214 of the total delivery of 1,545. Yet, they provided the larger proportion of stillbirths. Out of the 214, 79 of them were stillbirths because they were booked patients. They didn't receive any formal antenatal care. Whereas the booked patients that were 1,331, only 46 had stillbirths. And I'm sure the stillbirths they had must be those that are not within our control or that God did not enable us to control.
So we had our seabed rates of 33.4 in booked patients and 269.62 in unbooked patients, and a total of 74. And then the total deaths in first week of life, early neonatal deaths, was 23, giving us a total prenatal deaths, stillbirth was early neonatal deaths of 148, and then a prenatal mortality rate of 88.62. Next slide, the pregnancy outcome maternal in 2020, we have a maternal death in the booked patients, a death that could not easily be prevented. And then we have 7 maternal deaths in unbooked patients, deaths that virtually occurred just within minutes and few hours of arrival to our maternity unit because they've been messed up outside and then they were just virtually brought in here. Such patients, we still salvage many of them, but those that are not salvaged constitute a lot of menace to our statistics. But we have to portray them. They will have the total live births of 1,545, and then total maternity maternal mortality ratio of 518. Next slide. The summary of our vital statistics. HIV prevalence rate in FMSU Maya is 1.23%. The national average is 1.5. So we did so well, or we are doing so well. The serial section rate is 39.6. The national average is a range of 20 to 35.5. Still slightly high, but within fair accommodation. But contributed mainly by unbooked emergencies. Prenatal mortality rate is 88.62. National average is 40. If we project our prenatal mortality rate in booked patients, please, well, let me not take you back. You will see that it is much less than our national average. So it's the unbooked emergencies that are the problems we are having. And the unbooked emergencies portray the state of healthcare in the country. Actually, FMCMY is like the only functional tertiary hospital in our state. And it's the only hospital that is, you can regard as a dumping ground from everywhere. We come from Arushuku, come from Oki, they come from all sorts of places, even beyond the state to FMCMY. And by the time they get here, it's a mess. And these days of curfew is even worse because the delays have compounded. We know that there are delays in when it comes to maternal deaths. Delay in taking decision, delay in on transit, coming to the hospital, and then delay in the hospital from all the protocols. Summary of our vital statistics, like I said, is very good. And our medical director, being an obstetrician gynecologist, has been of great help. Fatherly encouragement comes to our meetings, comes to our dental clinic, goes to the maternity theaters, calls me on phone to ensure things are done right, calls the head of department, and all these have helped us a lot in achieving these statistics. Causes of maternal death in 2020. Specific causes. We have hemorrhage from uterine rupture. 2 were regular in unbooked patients. Antepartum preeclampsia and eclampsia. 2 regular in unbooked patients. Primary postpartum hemorrhage. 1 in unbooked patients. Obstructed labor complications. 1 in a booked patient. Because of delay. And because of the structure in getting to the hospital from your house. Then we have a septic shock, 1 in unbooked patients, and severe community acquired pneumonia, query tuberculosis or COVID-19. Diagnosis was not really confirmed, but it's a pneumonia. What caused it? Either TB or COVID-19. Next slide. Any causes of neonatal death, morbidity and mortality in FMSU Maya in the first week of life include severe prenatal asphyxia, prematurity, neonatal sepsis, hemorrhagic disease of the newborn, meconium aspiration syndrome, severe hyperbilirubinemia, kernicterus, cyanotic congenital heart disease, persistent pulmonary hypertension, other congenital malformations. These causes are similar to previously reported causes in Port Harcourt from the study we did in 2012. The late neonatal period to 6 weeks postpartum. This period, events that started during pregnancy, labor, and delivery can cause significant morbidity and mortality to the baby and to the mother in their journey. In conclusion, the prime, the first, the most important, though unpredictable, path of permit obtained by the deployed zygote to proceed on the longest journey on earth of 280 days from date of fertilization has been highlighted. The need to take action, to check other actions beforehand, with specified attention and preference in conformity with established ethical standards, has also been projected. The diversity of possibilities in the process from the embryonic to the fetal and to the full term period demand great dedication, devotion, determination towards provision of quality preconceptional care, antenatal care, intrapartum care, and postpartum care. Preconceptional care will assist women to reduce risk, promote healthy lifestyle, and improve readiness for pregnancy. Antenatal care will encourage early diagnosis and accurate dating of pregnancy. Prenatal diagnosis, evidence-based information and support to women and their husbands. Monitoring of maternal and fetal well-being and determination of timing of delivery. Good intrapartum care provided by proficient professionals in well-equipped health facilities, baptized and bestowed with the spirit of emergency preparedness, will not only provide profitable and positive protection to the precious passenger passing through this unpredictable process, but will also provide protection to the patient's parent, her partner, and the entire population. Thank you.
I want to thank those who for your patience. I didn't know I was doing this early.
I thank my old man who patience is with me. Thank you. And you're welcome. I thank my beautiful wife who is also a consultant. Yeah, I was mandated to thank you after my lecture because I know you've exercised a lot of patience trying to listen to me. Thank you so much. And God bless
you. You can do better than that. You can do better than that. What a wonderful lecture.
Nkrumah here to represent you in this event. Honestly, I wasn't happy. I wasn't happy because, you know, we have heard in the news about what has happened recently and nobody wants to go somewhere that you know that there may be a problem. But honestly, having come here, having listened to this distinguished lecture, I'm very, very happy that Mr. President chose me as a distinguished scholar. I will want to invite the scholar to come out, and I want to be supported by the chairman of the occasion and the chief host, so that we will present a token to him. But just before we give you this token, let me tell you something that happened last week. The president and I were invited by the president of NMA together with other affiliates to go to Abuja to represent NMA and all their affiliates in a meeting with the Honorable Minister of Labour and Productivity, Dr. Chris Ngeke. During the meeting, we discussed about the COVID allowance, which was not concluded. But one of the major highlights of the meeting was the increase in the retirement age of health professionals from 60 to 65 years and also consultants to 70 years. Even though it's work in progress, but at that meeting, we agreed in principle that that should be done. We've always known, we've always believed that our members in
fellow medical centers, in the specialist hospitals, and also in the teaching hospitals. You know, they are in their own rights, they are just like the professors within the university. And having been there today and listening to the guest, distinguished guest lecture, I am furthermore convinced in my mind that yes, that is the proper step to take. Another thing that needs to be done to complete the process, I believe, is for every person of good will to talk to federal government and to NUC and especially TechFund. You know, when I entered this institution, one of the major things that was lacking is TechFund presence. When you go to every ivory tower in this country and teaching hospitals, the major thing that you see within the premises is TechFund projects. And it's very, very much lacking in our federal medical centers, our specialist hospitals, and also the state hospital. So I think the distinguished guest is calling upon government to extend such guest services to the federal medical centers. You can see the quality of the quality that Dr. Onduka, and I'm very sure there are many among us that are just like him. So we need to be stimulated in order to be able to advance our research, to advance our teaching, and also for our patients' care. So I think it would be very nice if the federal government can extend that gesture to federal medical centers so that they will also step up their game. Sir, having listened to this beautiful presentation, I would want to, on behalf of the federal medical, all the consultants of Federal Medical Center, Umuahia, present to you this award, Distinguished Medical Specialist Award, for your erudite scholarly presentation.
This way. Yes. Just look this
way. They said behind every successful man is a woman, and also one is wife. I think it's a mistake. If his wife is around, she should also join us. And the dad, yes, that you can join us. So that you will see.
Yes.
Let it go.
Is she coming?
Yes.
Okay, let's wait for our photographers. Let her join us. Madam, please join us and support your husband in collecting this award from MDCAN Federal Medical Center.
Her space is there. Yes, please. Yes. Madam, go in between. In between. You are. Thank you. Good. Little chair. Okay. You can smile more.
Snap again.
Yes. Not a minute, sir. Yes, I think you can all sit down. This other part I can do it without. Yeah, you can give her the name. You know, everything, the beginning of everything is always the most difficult. Yes. Nobody wants to be used as guinea pig to test run the water. But you want to agree with me that Dr. Onduka has done that successfully. Yes. So having helped us in breaking the ice, you know, I would also want to again, on behalf of members of MDCAN of this hospital, decorate you with this award. This is the award for the Distinguished Medical Specialist, the inaugural edition of the Distinguished Medical Specialist. You have emboldened your colleagues, you have shown them how it's done, and I'm sure so many consultants will be on you booking to present this award from next year onwards. So I decorate you as a distinguished member. So henceforth, anybody that presents this lecture, you will be among those that welcome you into the fold. You are a pioneer member. Congratulations.
Please give a round of applause once more. Congratulations, Dr. Boka. At this point, we're going to sir, you can go also. Sir, you can join us. The inaugural lecturer can join us, sir. What is going on? Head of Clinical Services. We expect it to be here also. The Head of Clinical Services. Please join us. Please, the wife of the inaugural lecturer should join us. The wife. Is she around? Thank you, wife of the inaugural lecturer. Please, you can lay your hands on the cake, on the knife. We'll be cutting this cake with the spelling of Anatika. Ladies and gentlemen, please, you're going to help me with this part. While the toast cup goes round, please make it snappy. When I say give me N, you give me N. Alright, that's been the clarification right here. Yes. Alright, somebody give me N. I'm not hearing you. Someone give me N. Give me D. Give me C. Give me an A. And give me an N. What is that? Here they come. Please round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
Tremendously supported MDK. We are always here with you. We don't know what to present to you, but we package love and put it inside the bag. And want to present it to you as a bag of love. By the time it opens it, all we're losing out of this bag is love from MDK and MDK. So, sir, on behalf of and we can present this beautiful token of love to you to say thank you for all you have done for us. Thank you, sir. In the same way, we also want to appreciate our national president who came all the way from Plateau State. So, Kevin Zuri, ably presented by the Secretary General of the MPK for coming. You know, they hear a lot of stories about the Southeast, but he was still bold because we value this association so much that he came to be with us. We are also packaging love and putting it in a bag and giving it to him so that when he returns to Jos, by the time he opens this bag, the love of MPK. FMC Wire, the love of the good people of Abia State, and the love of the good people of Southeast Nigeria will flow out of this bag and will speak to the people that just like to see. Sir, on behalf of the MPK FMC Wire Chapter, we present this bag of love to you. Carry it very well and open it to your investors. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Please, if you have the one in your cup, just stand up wherever you are. If you're ready to attend, some people are even drinking their own. Please reserve your oil for the toast before I'm going to repeat water. Please reserve your wine for the toast. If you have your wine, you can stand up wherever you are, please. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen. The picture lady toast.
Those are the high table don't have.
Debbie Daniel made toast. No cup for my high table, please. This is an error. Someone should get cup for me, please. So sorry. Pardon our manners. Please be fast. With the wine. Alright, there's a wine here. To call on the head for clinical services and training, Dr. Ogochukwu Oyelaro, to help us with the toast.
A successful event. It is spreading and we want to appreciate God. You can also agree with me that the impact of this event first goes to the lecturer, and because we can't predict the extent to which the impact of today's event goes in his life. And also, the MDCAS as a professional group also are key beneficiaries of today's event. It's already speaking. Our institution, Federal Medical Center, also is leveraging on the opportunity presented by this event. Our partners, Gregory University, as well as the title of our country, Nigeria. So we are going to toast for the optimization of the critical opportunities presented by this event to all these people, and finally, to ourselves. Therefore, first, for the country, we are believing that the continuing of this lecture series will impact positively on our healthcare service delivery and improve health outcome. For our partners, Gregory University and others, we are toasting for improved productive collaboration with them. Not just as said, but also in practice, and it has begun to happen today. Actually, all that you had was happened today. And then furthermore, for us as an institution, Federal Medical Center, we are going to toast it for advancement for us as an institution, attainment of greater heights in training, research, and service delivery. And then for us as consultants, both Federal Medical Center, my chapter, and other well-wishers that are with us, we are toasting for more opportunities in our career and endeavors. And then finally, for the lecturer, we are toasting for more progression in your career. We want to believe that this should be a starting point for you. And for each and every one of us present, we are toasting that this series shall be sustained, and it shall go to increasing dimension. It shall have a greater impact, and that to the glory of God and for the prosperity and blessing of all consultants. Please, shall we toast? Please kick it, let it cause.
You get toast. Why did you give us some something? You can go ahead and toast. You can also taste and toast with the Samadana. The number lecturer today, Dr. Ayinayan Tuka. You can toast with him. Also toast with the MD. Heaven's Food Warrior, Professor. As you can go to the chief. Also with the National Guest, the Shaman's Go Kitchen. Also with the Khan. Oh my God. Wonderful.
met in a special way the Almighty God, who made this thing possible, who kept us alive. Because if, for instance, something tragic happened yesterday, we will not all be here happy the way we are. So we'll give all glory to God. I want to thank in a special way the specialness of our Professor Ken Ozeiro, ably represented by our dynamic National Secretary of Anglican, Dr. Rosa Chenna, for coming all the way from Jos, making two flights, you know, in order to come to Maya today, because they gave it a national outlook. I've already posted in the national blog the presence of MDCAN, National MDCAN in reference to Maya today. So everybody there is recognizing it. The chairman of this occasion, Professor Mbappe, the VC Gregory University, for coming and being with us, he gave his a university touch. Our indefatigable medical director, Professor Onyebuchi Azubuike. I don't know if he had not given his blessing and all his support so far, with the cordial working relationship that has been existing in the hospital since he came, and that could be related to what we're enjoying today. We thank him in a special way. The CMAC, Head of Clinical Services and Training, Dr. Nama, for his ample support. We thank you for coming. My chairman, MDCAN. Well, if the chairman, the truth is that he was giving glory to him because he nurtured this. It was his brainchild primarily. Because he started it. Somebody give back to that. I don't know. I was being distracted somehow when the lecture was going on, but I know that there will be a fertilization before even embryo and fertilization comes to take place. So I believe he had both the sperm and the egg. Okay? Came from him, and both of them met and then got fertilized. And of course, the delivery, the progression and the delivery was carried on by somebody. Somebody I will recognize last. And we thank in a special way our special guest from Asaba, Calabar, Port Harcourt, and several places that came to grace this occasion. The wife of the distinguished lecturer, we thank you in a special way for your support. Then, the distinguished lecturer. The truth is that many people, or some people, have actually done some work in this center. But it's not everybody that's ready to put it down in a lecture series this way. But when he was asked to come, because we know he had done a lot, he took it. Took the rule by the mouth and then decided that he was going to do it. And we all see, we all witnesses to what have been done today. So give special thanks to our distinguished lecturer, Dr. Inna, for accepting to do this and doing it very well. Because if you have not done it very well, you never will be happy with it. We thank all the guests, the special consultants, and all the guests that come here today. This is the first event. This is the first event I've attended that doctors come in their number this way. In fact, since I took the question, this is the only event. And I was very happy. That was the end for whatever we did in MDCAN Hall. No, okay? And so, we thank you in a special way because without you, we are hooked, we are dressed as the academic and graced in the function, graced in the occasion, it wouldn't really look like that lecture of which you meant to be. So we thank you for coming. We thank you for coming on time. We thank you for all your attention when the lecture was going on. Then, the last and not the least, the man that nurtured this. Through the embryonic stage,
another state. You know, I forget how they say that. We will be up to this moment. The NOC chairman and his team. The NOC chairman stood out. Of course, we know him. I usually take thanks and glory. You know, our people, the part of the world I come from. When you see somebody doing very well, who has gone through apprenticeship and then has gone to China and import something, instead of going to somewhere to begin to do that, learn how to unwind him and everything, you now approach him to ask him to tell me how you did this thing. And that's why there are so many millionaires in the part of the world where I come from. It is not by. So whenever you see somebody who is doing something that you cannot ordinarily do, you encourage that person, you emulate that person, so that is the only way you become great. Because we know him, Professor Kolobin, some of us, and he started something, a series that you cannot bet. Even if you don't like it, you must join. Okay? And he now, when the chairman was looking for somebody to give this thing, we met our eyes to say, who else? He has to be the digital guru. Somebody that can make this thing look. Because if you give me this thing, so when I'm not an investor, the truth is that this thing will be like this. Okay? I know what, and each of us know ourselves. So this young man led his committee. And we were able to see he walked through the line. All of us, even this speech I'm giving now, he had to come to put with you. Because he doesn't want anything, any mistake. He believes in excellence. And of course, we have seen it through today. Dr. Ike Chukwuebonah, please stand up. This is a man, and I've told him, with the panel, I know the medical director, because I know if you talk to him, he doesn't agree, the medical director talks to him, you won't. And I told him that he will be a life committee chairman of this inaugural assembly, and to raise money at the place. So we thank you in a special way for meeting you, you are your also, Jodeh, Nata, and all the other members that are came as the television. We are grateful that this has come to pass. And then all your technical staff, led by your admin officer, Shinken, we always appreciate you for your support. Whenever we come to the office, we see all these things and know that it doesn't do it alone. And of course, without all the efficient technical staff, these things will not come to pass. The band, the MC, So, we have recognized you and believe that we will see you some other time. So, we thank everybody and we pray Almighty God that as we depart from this place, all of us we shall find favor in Jesus' name. Thank you.
We're just overjoyed by the beauty of today's occasion. Father, we want to appreciate you especially for the good weather. We want to thank you for the perfect organization, Lord. We want to just appreciate you for this well-organized, epoch-making. We just want to thank you, Lord God, for this landmark event that will birth many more beautiful ones in Jesus' name. Our Lord and our Heavenly Father, for all the resources committed for the guest, the distinguished lecturer, Father, Lord God. Father, replenish his wisdom, replenish him in letting the world rested after this, Lord. Everlasting King of glory, even as we depart, Lord God, as we go to our various destinations, we pray, Lord God, for your protection, Lord God, until we get to our homes in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. For every other occasion that MDCAN has in its womb, O Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, because it shall be birthed without with ease in the mighty name of Jesus. Be thou exalted because we have prayed in Jesus' name. Amen.